Workshop C is on socialization and cognitive training, and I'll begin by thanking our sponsors. May is Mental Health Month, and to celebrate, we're holding this series of mental well-being and memory workshops. They have been generously funded by the LA County Department of Mental Health in collaboration with California Mental Health Services Authority. And I'll introduce you to our team. We are the Lifestyle Program at Pacific Neuroscience Institute Foundation, and we're experts in brain wellness and lifestyle behaviors to support quality longevity and brain health. Our team specializes in neuropsychology, geropsychology, cognitive training, exercise, and nutrition. We're currently offering classes and individual sessions on site in Santa Monica or virtually. This series is also brought to you at the Santa Monica YMCA on Thursdays. So you may notice here that I am a registered dietitian, a brain health coach, and a memory trainer. So if you have any kind of burning questions along those lines, please feel free to ask at the end of the presentation today, as time allows. I'd be more than happy to discuss any of those topics. So let's start today. The goal here is to give you a brain workout that we'll do our own cognitive training together. So let's start with verbal fluency. This is a cognitive function that facilitates information retrieval from memory. Verbal fluency is closely linked to various cognitive functions and serves as a significant indicator of cognitive health. Verbal fluency tasks require the generation of words under specific constraints, engage multiple cognitive domains, including language, executive function, memory, and processing speed. We had a question about translating. I believe that you can use the translating and closed captioning. All right, so let's talk about ways to enhance verbal fluency. So one way is to read books or articles, and even consider doing this aloud to expand vocabulary and improve pronunciation. Another option is to try the ABC exercise by saying words that begin with the same letter as quickly as possible. So I'll give a quick example here. I could run through some A words like apple, authority, able, aardvark, and awesome. Once I slow down in terms of my ideas with the letter A, I could move on to B and then C and go through the whole alphabet. Another way to practice verbal fluency is to choose a topic and generate words associated with it. For example, you could think about animals or colors, foods, and generate words along those lines. This is when categorization, which we've discussed in the past, can really be helpful to you. For instance, if I want to come up with a number of animals, I might think about zoo animals, marine animals, birds of flight. I might think about farm animals. So pulling your categories, you can imagine this could be helpful with food. We have those food groups we went over last time. So that can be helpful in terms of these topic areas. And then lastly, if you enjoy technology, you could use cognitive training apps, which help you practice verbal fluency, like BrainHQ, Luminosity, and Dacom. So we will also practice some verbal fluency here together. So I'd like you to generate a list of social opportunities. Places, things to do where you could be social with other people. So I'll give you a moment to do that. All right. Well, I'll share with you my list and we'll see how many we have in common here. So you could do a group exercise class. That would be a way to be social. Volunteering. Joining a book club. Live music. Hiking and walking clubs. Senior or community center activities. Travel or a day trip, an excursion, that would be a way to meet someone new and socialize, as well as art or other hobby classes. So, social connections and cognition, let's talk about that link. So, loneliness in older adults increases the risk of cognitive decline by 40 to 60%. Married and partnered individuals and those who report multiple close friendships appear to have lower risk. Socialization combined with other forms of cognitive enrichment or physical activity seems helpful in preventing or slowing cognitive decline. And how does socialization impact mental health? Socializing provides emotional support and reduces feelings of loneliness and isolation. Positive social interactions release hormones like oxytocin and serotonin, which can improve mood and reduce stress. Meaningful conversations and interactions contribute to the formation of new neural connections and strengthen existing ones. Engaging in social activities often involves remembering names, faces, and details of conversation, which exercises memory functions. Social interactions may contribute to neuroplasticity, which is the brain's ability to adapt and reorganize itself in response to new experiences and learning. The sense of belonging and emotional support from social relationships can lead to a more resilient brain. So let's get back to our brain training here and do a bit of visual scanning. Visual scanning and visual attention are important for processing information. Efficient reactions require quick scanning of our surroundings. Visual scanning involves gaze control, spatial orientation, and systematic exploration. So I'll have you practice visual scanning on the following slide by learning where people are most impacted by loneliness. So here we have the loneliest states in America. So I'll have you scan this visual and then answer a couple of questions. Number one being, which state is the loneliness? Excuse me. Which state is the loneliest? And where does California rank? So you may have noticed that this key is pretty essential here. What we can learn by this key is that red indicates the most lonely states, while blue is the least lonely states. So to answer our first question, which state is the loneliness, low loneliest? Whoa, that one's hard for me. I need to practice my verbal fluency with that one. What we notice is looking at the red states, number one here is Maine, meaning that Maine has more lonely people than the other states in the US. Our second question, where does California rank? Now we need to look at, well, we really don't. We need to find California. And then we see it's blue. It's a least lonely state, which is great. How least lonely is it? It's number three. So who beat out California? Utah and Hawaii. So it's pretty interesting to think about why that might be the case. What do these three states have in common? And what might Utah and Hawaii have a little more of than California? So let's shift gears here and talk a little bit about social well-being. Sociologist Corey Keyes defines social well-being as an individual self-report of the quality of his or her relationships with other people, the neighborhood, and the community. Social well-being is subjective. It's based on how you perceive your relationships with friends, family, and others. What matters most is the quality, not quantity, of your relationships. You can feel socially healthy with just one or a few close connections. Social well-being stems not only from your individual relationships, but also from a sense of belonging to larger groups within your community. So thinking about social health, that can be one of our pillars here. We all know that physical health is really important, and hopefully with this series, mental health has also makes a lot of sense to most of you. That's our second pillar. And now we have this aspect, another aspect to our health, social health. So social health is the aspect of overall well-being that stems from connection and community. To summarize decades of scientific studies, our relationships determine both how well we live and how long we live. Research shows that positive, satisfying relationships are one of the best predictors of health across the lifespan. So I'd like you all to take your own social health assessment by asking a few questions. Have you been feeling more connected or lonely recently? Which relationships do you value the most? What kinds of interactions energize you, and what kind drain you? So I'll give you a moment to consider these three questions. So depending on how you assessed yourself, you can consider a couple ways to strengthen your social muscles. One would be to broaden, to seek out new relationships by joining a hobby club or interest group, volunteering in your community, or attending an event. Another option would be to deepen your relationships, so prioritize quality time with a friend or family member, where you put devices and other distractions away and focus on having a meaningful conversation or engaging in a shared experience. So let's get back to our brain training with face name. So here in this next few slides, we will use the face name memory technique while also reviewing exercise recommendations. You may meet new people in the context of exercise, for instance, a group class, working with a personal trainer, or joining a walking group. So for memory practice today, we'll use the face name technique. Not recalling names is the most common form of forgetting as we age. The brain has plasticity, and name recall can be improved with strategies like face name technique. So there are a couple steps here. First, we want to actively pay attention. And next, we'll create a visualization of a face with their name by using a few different things. We have options here. So we can use what you notice about their appearance, any associations you have for their name, or information you learn about them to provide context. So first up is cardiovascular exercise. This is recommended for brain health and general health as well, 2 to 3 times a week. And some examples of cardiovascular exercise are jogging, walking, or hiking, swimming, cycling, boxing, and dancing. So this is your gym friend, Ted White. He's on the elliptical cardio machine here. You see him in the cardio room. And our task in terms of face name is, how will we recall that this gentleman's name is Ted White? So I suggest you come up with an association for Ted and also for White. It's probably going to be perhaps two associations, or maybe you'd have one that includes them both. So I'll give you a moment to think about that. So I will share with you my favorite association for Ted White, which is a white teddy bear. So my visualization might be a fluffy white stuffed teddy bear that's sitting on a bed, perhaps in a child's room, or maybe I would think about a white polar bear. The reason why this works for me is Ted here has white hair and a white beard. That's what people usually notice about him first. And then for Ted, I'm going to think of a teddy bear. Maybe he has a teddy bear-like personality. So that's my association for Ted White. You can use mine or use your own. Next up, we have resistance training. This is also recommended 2 to 3 days a week. And some examples are sit-ups, squats, leg raises, weightlifting, and resistance bands. So you're in a strength class, and this is the woman next to you. Her name is Carol Draper. What will you associate with Carol and Draper to recall her name? So I have a few things that I think of in terms of Carol Draper. Perhaps she doesn't care about hanging drapes. She's not worried about people seeing her doing her resistance training. Another I think about in terms of names, I don't know any Carols, but I do recall that one of the characters in Mad Men was named Draper, his last name. So that's an association you could make. However, my favorite is that she wears drapes to go caroling. So you are welcome to use any of mine or your own associations. Oftentimes people will tell me they have a friend or a family member named Carol. That's a really good way to associate between the Carol you know and this Carol in your strength class. Next up, we have skill-based exercise. This is recommended 2 to 3 days a week as well. And some examples are Tai Chi, basketball, bocce ball, and ping pong. So we have one more name to work on here. This is our Tai Chi instructor, Wilma Starr. There's, again, a number of ways that you could make associations here, and I'm going to give you a moment to think about your own. So depending on your generation and interests, you may recall Wilma Flintstone. At the beginning of the Flintstone cartoon, Fred Flintstone screams, "Wilma!" So that's what I always think of when I think of Wilma. So Wilma Flintstone was certainly a star in the day, and now she's retired and she leads Tai Chi classes. That might be one way to think about it. Another way might be Wilma is an up-and-coming YouTube star who has Tai Chi videos. So we could ask ourselves, will Ma, maybe she's your Ma, I don't know, will Ma become a star? I hope so. So here we have will Ma, right, become a star. Wilma, star. So please visualize whatever associations that you're going to use, whether that's something you came up with on your own, Wilma Flintstone, the retired star from the cartoon, or will Ma become a YouTube star? So let's talk about all the ways that you could foster socialization in your life. Number one, maintain relationships. Stay connected with family, friends, and colleagues through regular conversations, phone calls, and visits. You could join clubs or groups. So participate in clubs, interest groups, or community organizations related to your hobbies and interests. You could volunteer. Volunteering not only benefits others, but also provides opportunities for social interactions and a sense of purpose. Attend social events, workshops, lectures, and community gatherings to meet new people and engage in discussions. You could also join online social networks, utilizing online platforms to connect with people who share your interests, even if face-to-face interactions are limited. You can stay active by engaging in physical activities or exercise classes that promote group interactions and social engagement. Cultural and recreational activities. Participate in cultural events, theater outings, art classes, and other recreational activities that encourage socialization. And then there's community resources. Check out your local parks and recreation departments, YMCA, senior, or community centers. I know my local community center is where I take my exercise classes, and they also have lots of events throughout the summer. So that would be an interesting thing to look into this season. And then some resources for you. One thing that you could do is find a local meetup group. Meetups are neighbors getting together to share something they have in common. And this is an online resource. A couple examples. My husband's been in a coffee meetup group for over 10 years. And the book club that I'm in is a meetup group. So that certainly can be successful for some people. It has in my life. You could also look for volunteer opportunities near you with Volunteer Match, and then you could find local or online support groups for specific concerns. Online support at Daily Strength and the National Alliance on Mental Illness has online and in-person groups. All right, recall time. Do you recall these three people that you met at the gym? So think about your visualizations. For the first gentleman, I'm visualizing a white teddy bear. He is Ted White. For the woman in the middle, I'm wondering, will Ma become a YouTube star with her Tai Chi? It's Wilma Starr. And then lastly, I'm imagining this woman pulling her drapes down, wrapping herself up in them to go out caroling. It's Carol Draper. So I hope you did well with this little recall exercise. Another challenge you could give yourself is, can you recall these names later, like after the presentation, this afternoon, this evening? That would be delayed recall, so it's something you could try. Now let's dive into cognitive training. Cognitive training refers to engaging in activities that challenge and exercise the brain's cognitive functions, such as memory, attention, problem solving, and reasoning. These activities are believed to have a positive impact on brain health and overall cognitive function. Mental exercise is like a session at the gym. In this case, your brain is getting the workout. So there are a number of cognitive training types. First up, we have attention. This includes selective, sustained, and divided attention. Executive functioning targets higher order processes involved in planning, organization, problem solving, decision making, inhibition, and cognitive flexibility. Processing speed exercises the speed and efficiency with which individuals process and respond to information. Visual spatial skills include spatial perception and orientation, mental rotation, spatial memory, and visual imagery skills. Language involves language processing, verbal fluency, vocabulary, reading comprehension, and communication skills. Memory training aims to improve different aspects of memory, such as working, short-term, and long-term memory. So let's practice our visual spatial skills. Visual spatial skills refer to cognitive abilities that allow individuals to perceive, analyze, and mentally manipulate visual information in relation to space and objects. These skills are crucial for tasks such as reading maps, assembling puzzles, understanding spatial relationships, and activities like driving or playing sports. One key brain region associated with these skills is the parietal lobe, which plays a vital role in processing sensory information and integrating it with other cognitive functions. Changes to the parietal lobe can lead to difficulties with basic hand-eye coordination, problems recognizing familiar places or objects, and exhibit challenges in understanding maps or reading diagrams. So let's practice our visual spatial skills. One way to do that is with drawing. So utilizing your visual spatial abilities, please draw the following: a stop sign as well as a tree. If you cannot or prefer not to draw at this time, you can draw in the air with your finger as an alternative. So I'll give you some time to draw a stop sign and a tree. All right. Well, I'm curious if your drawings looked anything like these two. I imagine your stop sign might have included the word stop. Did you have the same angles on your stop sign? Did you have a palm tree, or was it another type of tree, like a maple tree or a cedar tree? Was one more difficult than the other? I think if you gave this task to my husband and I, he's an engineer, I think he would really do much better on the stop sign and probably have a really good idea about how many sides there are than the tree. So this is an interesting thing to think about. I'd encourage you all to do some drawing and sketching from time to time as a way to work on your visual spatial skills. Let's talk about cognitive training and brain reserve. The brain's ability to reorganize itself by forming new neural connections is known as neuroplasticity. Cognitive training can promote neuroplasticity, leading to the creation of new pathways and networks within the brain. This can help maintain cognitive function even as we age. Engaging in mentally stimulating activities throughout life can contribute to building a cognitive reserve or brain reserve. So let's go over more of the benefits here of cognitive training. It can lead to improvements in various skills, including memory, problem solving, critical thinking, and information processing. Research suggests that individuals who engage in mentally stimulating activities may have a reduced risk of developing cognitive disorders, such as Alzheimer's disease and other forms of dementia. Learning new things, solving puzzles, and engaging in hobbies can provide a sense of accomplishment and satisfaction, leading to improved mood and reduced stress. So, how much of this do you need in your life? So the dosage for cognitive training can be measured in frequency and duration. Generally, shoot for at least 30 minutes of cognitive training per day. If desired, you could do a little bit less, like in the 20 to 30 minute zone instead, if you feel like your plate is quite full. So let's talk a little bit about executive functions, and in particular, cognitive flexibility. The three areas of executive function include working memory, cognitive flexibility, and inhibitory control. Cognitive flexibility enables us to adapt to changing environments, control our actions, and manage multiple tasks. It helps us change course when our initial solution to a problem doesn't work. So the executive functions are in this pink frontal lobe here. So I'm going to have you practice yourself. So with cognitive flexibility, I'm going to have you imagine the situation. You've misplaced your wallet. Please list the most important next steps. All right, well, I managed to come up with some here. I'm wondering if you have something different than I do. So the first thing I might do would be to retrace my steps and recall when the last time I used my wallet. Another option could be to look through my purse and my pockets and my car, any place that it may have been. And then I consider, if it's truly lost, what steps do I need to take, which might be reaching out to my credit card companies. And lastly, I would need to replace that ID, so maybe contacting the DMV. Now let's talk about that connection between cognitive training and mental health. Cognitive training can equip individuals with effective coping strategies to deal with stress, adversity, and negative emotions. By improving problem-solving abilities and cognitive flexibility, individuals may be better equipped to adapt to challenging situations and regulate their emotions, leading to better mental health outcomes. Neuroplasticity from cognitive training can lead to structural and functional changes in the brain that support better mental health outcomes, such as improved mood regulation, stress resilience, and emotional well-being. So, I'm going to tell you a little bit more about cognitive training and mental health outcomes. So the research behind it here, research has linked cognitive training interventions to reduce symptoms of various mental health disorders. Interventions often target specific cognitive deficits associated with these disorders, such as attentional bias, working memory deficits, or rumination, with the goal of improving overall functioning and symptom management. Successfully completing cognitive training exercises can enhance the belief in ability to accomplish tasks and achieve goals. This increased self-confidence can translate into improved mental health outcomes as individuals feel more empowered to overcome challenges and pursue meaningful activities. And I can share that when I work with people with memory training, that they do develop a lot of confidence around their abilities. So I think it really can be very helpful in that way, subjectively, in addition to the research that we have. So let's do a little more cognitive training. I thought we'd bring back the story method today. So this is a method to aid memory. And here are the steps. So when you have a list of things you'd like to recall, what you can do is make up a sentence or sentences that contain the items you want to remember. Visualize each part of the story. Retell the story to jog your memory of the items to recall. And some pro tips are your story will come alive when you use your senses to write it. And silly, fun stories are easier to recall. So I have a word list for you. I'd like you to use some or all of the following words to create a story. So the words here to use in your story are book, neuroplasticity, tai chi, mood, stop sign, volunteer, and red. So you can use all of the words, you could use three or more of the words, whatever you feel comfortable with. I'll go ahead and share my story. I'll say I don't think it's actually the most creative or emotional story in the world, but I can visualize myself doing it. It could certainly be rewritten to be a little more creative, a little more emotional. But here's what I came up with. I was in the mood for a good book, so I volunteered to drive to the library. I paused at the red stop sign and noticed a Tai Chi group in the park. Knowing social engagement like group exercise could increase my neuroplasticity, I vowed to come back and participate. So I'm just looking over the story here and visualizing myself doing this. I think it might work a little bit better if I even said we were in the mood. I don't think I volunteered to myself. We were in the mood for a good book. So I volunteered to drive to the library. I paused at the red stop sign and noticed a Tai Chi group in the park. Knowing social engagement, like group exercise, could increase my neuroplasticity, I vowed to come back and participate. So I can visualize myself being in the mood for a good book, maybe with a family member, volunteering to drive to the library. I'm at that stop sign. I look over and I see Tai Chi in the park, and I think, oh, that would be so great for my neuroplasticity. I'm coming back. So, here are some cognitive training recommendations. Taking up new skills or hobbies, such as playing a musical instrument, learning a new language, or trying out a new form of art. Activities like crossword puzzles, Sudoku, chess, and strategy games challenge the brain's problem-solving abilities and memory. Regular reading exposes the brain to new ideas, vocabulary, and concepts, promoting cognitive growth. Participating in online courses or workshops in various subjects can provide intellectual challenges and learning opportunities. So I want to emphasize how important it is to have novelty. I really encourage you to challenge your brain with new activities. And one way to do this would to be modifying a long-standing hobby, maybe something you're very good at. So if you enjoy nonfiction, could you try reading a novel or maybe even some poetry? If you're an avid knitter, could you consider taking up embroidery? If you love the mind-body exercise of yoga, could you try Tai Chi as well? And if you play one puzzle really often, like let's say you do Wordle every morning, maybe try something different with numbers instead of letters, like Sudoku. And then I have some pro tips for you in terms of cognitive training. So often, what you avoid doing is actually what is needed. So if you find some task challenging, know that a challenge is good and that that might be something that you could really focus on. I work with a lot of people who say, oh, well, I've never been good with names. And so, of course, why would I be good at them now? Just because you have historically not really excelled at knowing people's names, even as a young person, does not mean you cannot learn that skill now. And in fact, that shows us an area that would probably really be supportive of your cognition to work on. So, too much of one activity may not be ideal. You want to diversify. I have worked with some people who are just wonderful at certain games like Sudoku. They're at that very high level and it's something they could spend an hour or two on every day. So that is impressive, and I think it's great that people find something they enjoy and that they've worked up to that skill level. At the same time, doing something new would give your brain a new challenge and give you more benefits in terms of training. So knowing that, cognitive training should sometimes be difficult, challenging, complex, and/or novel. So if it comes really easy, that can be enjoyable, but perhaps not giving you enough challenge to really push you forward. You want to be pushing that envelope. And the principle of use it or lose it can apply. I often hear from people that their writing skills have really gone downhill, and they tend to not write as much because of that. So in that case, I would really encourage writing. So can you do some journaling? Can you write a letter? Can you handwrite things that maybe you would do on your phone just so you can practice? You want to continue to use those muscles, because not using them isn't going to help to improve that area. So creating external accountability can be really helpful. One idea of this might be coaching. You know, as a brain health coach, I provide accountability for people. We have a lot of technology these days that can provide accountability. For instance, if you have a BrainHQ account, it will trigger you, or you can set up reminders to play notifications on your phone. Lastly, social activity may help. So if you get involved with cognitive training in a class, a group, or with a friend, that can be really helpful to keep you motivated, because you don't want to let down the other people, right? You might show up for them, and because you've made a commitment to others. So I'd be amiss to not talk about the cognitive training that we do at the Pacific Neuroscience Institute Foundation. Of course, you're getting a taste of it with this series. And we also do a lot of memory techniques in our Vital Minds classes, in memory care. So these are the techniques that we've gone over in the workshops, and that we also do within our programs, which are attention visualization, the story method, categorization, and phase name. So some resources for you all to explore. As I've mentioned, there are cognitive training programs that you can do on your computer or on another device like a tablet or a phone, which are BrainHQ, Luminosity, Dacom. There are more, but these have a lot of good research behind them, these three. And then I really enjoy the Duolingo app for language learning. It's free if you can put up with some ads, and they have just a tremendous variety of languages. You could certainly take classes. The Santa Monica College has a wonderful emeritus program that you could look into. And then there are also online courses with edX and other providers. You can look at online museum exhibits. Google's Arts and Culture is really incredible for art as well. And the Metropolitan Opera has opera on demand. So time for our recall with the story method. So recalling either your story or mine, or a combination of the two, how many of the seven words can you retrieve? Here's that list to compare. We have mental health resources to share as well. Want to make note of these, so when you have your copy of this presentation, you'll know they're here for you. And another big thank you to our sponsors, LA County Department of Mental Health and the California Mental Health Services Authority, as well as another snapshot at our team. At the PNIF Brain Wellness and Lifestyle Program, we provide education and support for individuals and families looking to optimize their brain health and address memory concerns or cognitive changes. We have programs like Vital Minds, fit brain, health coaching, individualized memory consults and planning, memory care, and caregiver support groups. We provide in-person, individual, and group services in our Santa Monica locations, as well as virtual options. And here's our card. I'm going to leave that up for a moment in case you want to copy this. All right. Well, thanks so much, everyone. I hope you have a great afternoon, and I'm looking forward to seeing you all next week. Bye-bye.